The next thing I need to say up front, this is the usual IMF disclaimer. I'm not here on any IMF business. I do not represent any IMF policies of any kind. In fact, I'm here in a totally private capacity. I took leave to come here because I have always learned a great deal from the expertise that in this room every September in terms of monetary history and monetary matters. And I do not identify with any of the political opinions that have been expressed here this morning. I don't want to be associated with any of that. This is purely economic research, all right? Okay, so the 1930s Chicago plan, as you know, to some extent, I have to say, when I present this here, I'm preaching to the converted, and a lot of what's on these slides is typically for people that are not converted. Okay, but bear with me because I don't think everybody in this room has the same understanding that Stephen and others have. So I'm just going to give the usual presentation. And for some of you, some of these bullets may be obvious, but bear with me. So in the 1930s, there was a very deep debate about monetary reform and how to get the economy out of the Great Depression and how to make the financial system safer. And when I read that literature, and you know, I may not even have read enough because there is a wealth of information out there, what struck me is that the level of understanding that these economists displayed about how the financial system works was actually deeper than what today's economists display in some very fundamental ways. Now, you know, it's not the same financial system, but the very fundamental, I mean, today's financial system is more complicated, but the very core of how money is created in this financial system is not different today from what it was then, and that is actually the central issue that you need to understand before you go out and model and banks and talk about policies, okay? So, the plan was supported by Fisher, Henry Simons, Frank Knight, the last two teachers of Milton Friedman, many leading economists. Okay, I had a discussion last night with Professor Huber that, you know, there was a great variety of plans. Not all of these were the same, right? So Chicago plan is kind of an umbrella term for plans that differed along various dimensions, and my particular representation of it may not precisely match a single one of them, right? But the spirit is the same. So what the Chicago plan proposed is the separation of the monetary and credit functions of banking, meaning, and I will expand on this, that deposits and or money, which are terms that I will treat interchangeably, use interchangeably, must be backed 100% by, you could call it public reserves or by public money. Public money is a better term here. And that credit cannot be financed by creation of bank deposits ex nihilo or out of nothing. And I will definitely explain what that means. All right? So so the plan of the talk is I want to first of all get a lot of misunderstandings out of the way about how banking system works. Then I will talk about the various advantages of the Chicago plan. Then I will talk about one major objection, that it might be inflationary, which is that big boogaboo that you always find out there from people, you know, Austrians and various characters like that. I will spend a little bit of time on that. There are other objections that I have encountered in the meantime. They are dealt with in that updated version of the paper. And virtually none of them stands up to scrutiny. The only one that stands up to some scrutiny is that there is always a danger that banks are going to run rings around any definition of money that you might want to adopt and try to create substitute monies. That is the one objection that stands up to any scrutiny. And it's valid, but it was recognized and not deemed to be very important by Simons, or not insurmountable by Simons and others. Okay, so, and after that I will conclude. So I'll start by getting some misunderstandings out of the way about how banks work. Right? First, the key function of banks is money creation and not intermediation. And you know, I very much work in cutting edge, graduate level, macro and monetary economics. I referee papers for leading journals. I just did one last week And all of them, at least all of them that I have seen so far, treat banks as intermediaries. If you do a word count on intermediaries in those leading article leading articles, leading journal articles, it's overwhelming. That's five a page, right? And it's completely wrong. And I will explain this now. What is meant, I mean, in some sense, in a very trivial sense, banks are intermediaries, but not in the sense that is used in this literature and also as a consequence in policymakers' minds. The intermediation that is economically meaningful and that people think of is the following. There is a bank, it takes savings from a non-bank, and then channels those savings on to another non-bank that needs the savings. 0% of banks' business is of that nature. 100% of finance companies' business is of that nature, and 100% of shadow banks' business is of that nature, but for banks, it's 0%. Okay? What banks do instead is to create new money out of thin air in the act of lending. And what that means, and I will go into more detail on the next slide, but I want to immediately draw your attention to the implications. It's very easy for banks to start a lending boom because all they need to do is to decide they want to lend more. They don't need to look for the funds anywhere. They make them on the spot when they lend. They create the funds. So that's like trying to run a car and making your own fuel as soon as you want to. As soon as you want to use it, this is quite miraculous. But that is possible. Okay. Important, and I'll also get to that. Reserves or cash balances impose no limits on this process, except during very exceptional economic times. And the only constraints, you know, I mean, you can't say, I mean, you can't go out there and say banks have no constraints. When they want to lend, they just create money. They do have constraints, but the only constraints are. Is this a profitable loan that I'm thinking about? And is this a loan that, if it goes wrong, puts my solvency at risk? So the whole bank could tank. You know, a bank cannot run irresponsible lending operations because it could tank, right? And so profitability of loans is a constraint. But I was a banker for 5 years, and the herding behavior in terms of thinking about how profitable a loan will be this year versus next year is incredible. You know, everybody is enthusiastic for quite a long time over, oh, no, there's no risk out there. The economy is cool. It's a new paradigm, and we're going to lend a lot. And next year, suddenly, everybody has turned on a dime. Okay? So that's why having profitability as the only constraint is really risky, because it leaves this constraint in the up to the sentiment of the banks about the business conditions out there in the economy. Now, let's talk about this money creation business a little bit more. Okay, so up there is the story of money creation, the loanable funds theory that, as I said, dominates virtually 100% of the cutting edge literature. Right. And that's somebody coming to the bank and depositing something, and it's the saver, and it's being channeled on to something else. But actually, before I go to this slide, I actually want to tell two more things, because you can think of intermediation as various different things. And the simplest is to think about somebody depositing a check in a bank. The reason why I'm mentioning that, I was in Sweden last week, and there was a fairly well-known economist. When I said banks are not intermediaries, and he said, wait a minute, when I take my savings to the bank, the bank is intermediating it, right? So I want to, and it's not on this slide, but I want to get this out of the way. When I have a check and bring it to the bank, I am transferring my deposit from one bank to another bank, and the overall amount of deposits in the economy changes by zero. And when I think about intermediation, I'm a macroeconomist. I don't care about an individual bank. I care about the aggregate banking system. And when something like that happens, that's a microeconomic phenomenon. And it does not, by one iota, change the amount of funds that's available to some borrower who may want to borrow. In fact, it's even more extreme than that, because the bank that does receive this deposit also does not have more funds to lend. Because the moment it gets the deposit, by double entry bookkeeping, which is something that a lot of economists don't understand, by double entry bookkeeping, it has already made the loan. Because the loan is made at that moment to the bank from which the deposit was withdrawn. I am lending as the bank. As soon as I receive a deposit, I am already lending to that bank from which the deposit was withdrawn. There are no additional funds for me to lend. Okay? And so that's very important. That you could also talk about cash, but cash is a very marginal item. And banks never lend out cash in the sense of doing an asset exchange on their balance sheet of saying, okay, I give you a loan and I give you cash instead. The only thing that banks do is say, I give you a loan, you get a deposit. And once you have a deposit, you can draw cash against that deposit. You cannot. The bank never lends out cash per se. So those are the alternatives. So I wanted to get those out of the way. But this is actually the story, and it's different. This is actually the story that people tell. It's even more extreme than that. It's completely bizarre. Okay, what happens? There's a saver who comes up to the bank with a truck and has a truck of carrots. He drives up and he dumps the carrots in front of the bank. And the bank, by double entry bookkeeping, records a deposit, and it also, because there has to be a corresponding asset, it now has carrots on its asset side. It owns carrots. And then the next thing that happens is the bank goes, oh, I have a potential borrower here, I lend you some carrots. And then you can take those carrots and try to exchange them for something else. Maybe you want to buy a machine or a computer. Your problem. Right? It sounds completely bizarre, but that is the story that you have to tell if you want to talk about banks intermediating funds. Because the check thing doesn't work, the money thing doesn't work. The only thing that works is that somebody brings real resources to the bank, and the bank then lends the real resources to some other guy who needs them. Okay? And then, so then we have two different guys, the saver and the investor, so the piggy bank and the factory sort of representing that, involved in this transaction. Okay? If this sounds completely ridiculous to you, it is because it is completely ridiculous. Okay? And so the correct view is that money is created in a different way. Somebody comes to the bank, some investor, and wants money, and the bank, once it decides that the project is okay, grants him a loan, $1 million, asset side of the balance sheet, by double entry bookkeeping. It's not rocket science. The other item is the new deposit recorded on the liability side of the bank, which is what this guy came to the bank for. He didn't want carrots. He wanted money. That's what banking is all about. Financing is about money. Okay? And so this investor now takes this money that has been created for him out of thin air. There was that money didn't exist before. Okay? And then he takes it and spends it on some goods. Okay? Think about this. This is very important, you know, and this pervades economics. There's this story that in order for there to be investment, there needs to be saving first. It's the opposite. What's happening is, in order for there to be investment, there needs to be financing, not saving. And financing is the creation of money. And the saving is the consequence of the financing. Because when this guy buys the machine with the money that has been granted to him, he gives it to some other guy who is happy to sit on that money and deposit it in his bank or in the same bank. And at that point, saving has happened. The financing has created investment and saving as a byproduct. Saving does not need to come before investment. This is very, very important to understand for economics. Okay. The second thing that we need to get out of the way is the deposit multiplier is a myth. Because, you know, the next objection of a conventionally trained economist would be to say, well, banks can create these loans, but they always have to put some cash aside or some central bank reserves, and that limits the amount of money that they can create this way. Completely wrong. So the deposit multiplier, the central bank fixes some narrow money aggregates, say cash, and that is then spent throughout the economy, deposited in the bank. The bank makes a loan, but not of the full amount, because it needs to keep some cash as a security, as a liquidity buffer. And so broad monetary aggregates are therefore a certain multiple of narrow monetary aggregates. Okay. Kidland and Prescott, no monetary economists, by the way, they're very much real economists, and they're Nobel Prize winners, and they refer to this as a myth. And they were referring actually to the monetarist era, not to today's era. In 1990, they did an empirical study, and basically what the outcome is, it turns the actual monetary transmission mechanism on its head. Right? What happened in the monetarist era is that broad money aggregates, which is the stuff that banks create, lead the cycle. This is a statistical expression. Leading the cycle means that, in a statistical sense, broad money comes before what happens to GDP and things like this. Okay? Whereas narrow monetary aggregates lag the cycle. So once GDP has expanded because broad money has expanded, then narrow money expands. Okay? So what this means, of course, is that the banks act first and reserves are the consequence. In the inflation targeting era, which is what we're in now, in virtually every country around the world, not all, but a lot of countries around the world, here the logic is even simpler. What you're controlling under inflation targeting is a nominal interest rate, a price. If you're controlling a price, you have to let the quantity adjust, meaning that you have to supply as much money, meaning central bank reserves that the banking system needs for its liquidity management, as the banks demand at that interest rate, because otherwise you can't defend that interest rate. Okay? There's virtually no exception to that, but when I presented this paper at the Fed, they said that for a few months during the Volcker era, there was an exception to that, when Volcker really put his foot on the brake and essentially tried to control narrow monetary aggregates, and of course, nominal interest rates went haywire. Okay, I still have to look into the historical evidence on that, but that's what people told me at the Fed. But that's, you know, that's basically saying, you know, look, banks, I'm willing to crush you if you don't play ball with me. That's not something that central bankers like to do, except at extremely rare times. Right? So the evidence for this, what I've just told you, the evidence empirically is overwhelming, and also institutionally. There were studies done at the Fed that basically said the deposit multiplier doesn't make any sense and it should be discarded. For all of these statements that I have here, there is ample documentation, not just from leading economists, but from central bank websites, recent statements that confirm this. You just need to read between the lines a little bit and put things together. Okay. Okay, so the conclusions, the transmission, as far as the money cycle is concerned, starts with loan creation, which is at the discretion of banks and depends on their perception of profitability of lending. That then leads to deposit creation one for one, and it ends with reserve creation, which is a consequence. And the neatest statement of that is by Alan Holmes, Vice President, New York Federal Reserve, 1969. In the real world, banks extend credit, creating deposits in the process, and look for the reserves later. That's exactly how it is. Then and today. And again, you can. There's more central bank statements than that one, but that one is the most succinct one. So this means that banks are almost fully in control of the money creation process, except for the policy rate. The policy rate does influence things. But once you set the policy rate, the residual, how much money banks create, is completely up to them. The Chicago plan would remove this control, so this is starting to look ahead now, because so far this is only about how does today's system work. It will remove this control so that banks would become intermediaries, real intermediaries, as in the textbook, of government-supplied money. No carrots being driven to the front of the bank. No, you take government-supplied money and intermediate that. And money creation would no longer be based on private debt creation, which is what we have today, because that's how I explained the process. Okay, so that's getting the misunderstandings out of the way. The next thing is what we're doing in the paper is we're building a state-of-the-art model of banks in a monetary economy, and we remove the mistake that pervades the literature, which is to model banks as intermediaries, and instead we model them as creator of the national money supply. Okay? And we have six advantages. Part of them were already identified by Fisher in his beautiful little booklet, 100% Reserves and the Public Debt, which is like a really short, succinct version of the 100% Money book. It's the most wonderful, I mean, this is better than anything I've ever read in an academic journal. And there's not one equation in there, not one piece of econometrics. 100% Money and the Public Debt. Okay? So, the first two advantages have to do with balance sheets. Dramatic reduction of the net public debt and of private debts. And before we go into any of the other advantages, this is what we need to understand. We need to understand balance sheets. Okay? For all of you, this is critical. Familiarize, if you're not already familiarize yourself with the principles of balance sheets. I think the top gets a little cut off here, so I don't know whether this is... It's out of your control? Okay. So, this is the U.S. balance sheet, consolidated banking system, the best way we could put it together from flow of funds data from the Fed in 2006. And all numbers in this balance sheet are in percent of U.S. GDP. Okay, and what we have on the asset side is government bonds, 20% of GDP. Of course, overall government bonds is about 80% of GDP around that time. The rest is not held by the U.S. financial system. It's held by the non-bank system and by foreigners and by the Fed. All right, but the Fed is... Yeah, okay. So, that's government bonds. Then we have short-term and mortgage loans. And what I lumped together in that is mortgage loans, working capital loans for firms, and consumer credit, which are about 60, 20, and 20% of GDP in 2006. Adds up to about 100. Of course, these are rough numbers, but the magnitude should be right. And by the way, what I'm doing here is I am consolidating the shadow banking system and the commercial banking system. The commercial banking system is just under 100% of GDP at that time, and the shadow banking system just over 100% of GDP. Okay? And then we have investment loans of 80%. So that's loans for constructing houses, building factories, acquiring machines, that kind of thing. On the liability side, I have deposits. Okay, and here we need to be quite clear up front. That's a very comprehensive set of liabilities of the bank. It includes anything from transactions balances to savings accounts to time deposits to bonds, blah, blah, blah. I am treating all of these as money, but not in the narrow cash sense of something that pays a 0% interest rate, but something that pays a lower interest rate than on risk-free bonds because it yields liquidity services, because you can do something with this that you cannot do with risk-free bonds. You can purchase stuff with it, okay? Or you can use it as collateral in financial transactions. I mean, the whole notion of money just being used for goods transactions is a bit narrow. Okay, this is important to remember because I will later on say that these deposits should all be 100% backed by reserves, meaning what I thereby include is all time deposits, all longer term liabilities of banks, because they all have some monetary characteristic. And I recently read the positive money proposal, and that's one of the two differences between the positive money proposal and this paper, is that they are only calling there for the backing of transactions accounts and not all bank liabilities. But there is a monetary reason for saying that all of these have characteristics of money, some more so, some less so. Right, So that's one difference I have with the positive money proposal. The other difference I have with the positive money proposal is that in this implementation that I'm playing through here, everything gets done overnight instead of letting loans mature and then being paid into a revolving fund, etc. Here, everything gets done overnight via a citizen's dividend. Otherwise, our basic understanding of how the system works and how you go from here to there is the same. All right. I also have bank equity here. And that is based on a thorough modeling of the Basel III regime with minimum capital adequacy rules, etc. This is all based on optimizing bank behavior, etc. This is state-of-the-art modern monetary economics. So the first stage of the Chicago plan is to say, bank, you have 184% of GDP deposits. They're not backed by anything except loans. I want you to back them with reserves or with cash, if you like that term better, because some people have trouble from the terminology point of view calling this reserves. I'm calling it reserves. Okay, but you can think of this as cash. These guys have to basically have put cash in the vault, electronic cash in the electronic vault, that is basically on the balance sheet of the Fed. Or whatever successor organization there would be to the Fed under this monetary system. Now, for the banks to get these reserves, they need to do something to get them. They need to issue an IOU to the Treasury in order to purchase these reserves, because they basically start off without reserves. Suddenly, in one afternoon, they're supposed to get them. The only way they can get them is by a stock transaction whereby they issue an IOU to the Fed or the Treasury. What this amounts to is the following. The banks have been creating money out of thin air, which is something that used to be a sovereign prerogative for decades, for centuries. And this transaction in one afternoon recovers the seigniorage, the stock seigniorage, the accumulated deposits that they have created up to that point to the public sector. Right, thereby making the whole system, as we will discuss, a whole lot safer and more productive. The next slide is then saying, look, there's nothing different on the next slide except that I've rearranged some of these blocks. The numbers are the same, but I've rearranged. I've basically now rearranged this into money banks down here, where the deposits exactly correspond to the reserves. And up there, you have the credit investment trust, which keeps all those loans on the balance sheet. Okay. Now, I had a discussion with Joseph Huber about this last night. Still has the notion that there has to be some reserves backing cash, but really this is no different from the idea of sovereign money. It's the same. It's basically saying these banks are basically managing accounts at the Fed, if you like, but they're providing privately things like SWIFT, the clearing system, etc., check clearing system, etc. That is provided privately against a fee, perhaps, because you want innovative businessmen to provide this service, etc., etc. There's no need to put that into the public sector. Okay? Now, in Jamie's terminology from yesterday afternoon, this wouldn't be on the balance sheet. This would be off balance sheet, basically treated as fiduciary. Doesn't really make any difference. I just wanted to keep track of where the quantities are remaining. What makes difference from now on, this is going to be throughout, it's going to remain like this. What is going to happen next is in the credit system. Okay. What the government can now do, it has this, essentially the 184 up there is a huge account that the government has in the banking system, a claim against the banking system. Right? This is that IOU that the banking system had to issue. It can then retire government debt as it matures or prepay it. And for simplicity in this particular model, I'm assuming that everything happens in one period. It's very much cleaner. Otherwise, you don't know what the hell is going on when you do this over a certain number of periods. Okay, but you can probably think about that too. So here, the government bonds that are sitting on the balance sheet are basically repaid as they mature, canceled, and the credit investment trust balance sheet becomes shorter by 20% of GDP. The next step is very critical. The government still has a huge amount of treasury credit sitting there. And We talked about this with Jamie yesterday. You know, what can you do with this? Can you use it for the current budget, or do you want to use it for something else? I think this is a one-off opportunity by the government to remove some of the distortions that exist in the economy at this point due to the fact that money has been created through debt, so that lots of people are up to their eyeballs in debt. And it is, essentially, this is not the only reason, but one reason for that is that we can only create our money through debt. This is not the only reason for debt. There will be debt remaining after this, because people are different, and some people are flush with cash, and other people need cash right now because they have an emergency. That will always remain. But the systemic reason that you need debt in order to create the money supply, that doesn't have to be there. Okay? And so what I'm assuming here, and this is just an illustration, you could do this in many different ways. This is a windfall, and you decide as the government democratically how you would use that windfall. I'm assuming that 100% of GDP is paid up gets 100% of the annual income of the economy, the average annual income. Everybody gets the same for fairness reasons, and then they decide what to do with it, right? And these citizens' accounts would be restricted in the sense that they have to be used in order to first repay any outstanding debt. And after, if you have something left over, you have a little nest egg. If not, your debts are at least gone, or at least part of your debts are gone. So when that happens, the citizens' accounts basically cancel against a lot of this outstanding debt, all, including all household debt. In this particular illustration, in reality, this wouldn't be the case. Okay? There are some simplifications in the model. Not all household debt would disappear, but in this model it does. Right? And we end up with credit investment trusts that look like this. Okay, so there's still lending for investment loans going on, financed by bank equity and treasury credit. The next step is very quick. The bank now has more equity than it needs for the Basel regulations because the equity supports a smaller amount of loans, so it can pay out a dividend to its shareholders. That's all that changes here. That's all. The next step, however, is interesting. At this point in time, there's still 60% of government debt outstanding out there in the economy, somewhere else. Okay, what the government could do with the remaining treasury credit is actually to retire that too, to get the government debt down to zero. It's just for illustrative purposes. What would happen if it did that? You would end up with a balance sheet like this, where the investment loans are still there, but they're now financed by private deposits, treasury credit, and bank equity. The reason why I show this is that when people look at this balance sheet, they say, oh, if you look at the credit system, the government is providing all the funding for credit. The government is heavy-handed, and it will interfere in the credit process and all that. Right? Free markets, we don't like that. Right? Not necessary. It's absolutely not necessary, because if you go here, there is still a small tranche of treasury credit there, 11% of GDP. But the rest is all private. But the important thing is that these deposits up there are not money. Whatever is in the credit system must not be money. It is a risky investment. So that means if you put it there and these guys lend to southern Spanish real estate, you better know that you could lose your shirt, because there is no government that would step in to save you. And there should not be a government that would want to step in and save you, because it doesn't have to. Because why do governments step in to try and save you? Is because they want to assure the safety of the payment system so that people don't lose their transactions balances that they need in order to pay for goods and services and financial things and whatever. That's completely not necessary here anymore, because that is insulated from whatever happens in the credit system. So if you invest in Spanish real estate and lose your shirt, tough luck. Okay? And that's, in a sense, that's very good. In fact, you could go further and say that all the funding, and this is Larry Kotlikoff's proposal from Boston University, is that all the credit up there should be funded by equity-like instruments. No debt anymore up there. I don't want to be that extreme, and I don't do it in this proposal, but it's also possible. In which case, whenever the Spanish real estate defaults, you just get a haircut. That's like when you own a share in some internet stock. Right? It would be the same story. The Treasury credit can then be used to, at the margin, to infuse additional funds into the economy if you think that private banks are not sufficiently willing to lend to support the economy. But that's up to you. That's policy discretion. Now, the next thing is very important. This connects again to Jamie's presentation yesterday. And this is the government balance sheet. On the left is the initial government balance sheet. On the right is when everything is over. And in the middle is the government balance sheet when you just have started to back your deposits by reserves of public money. Right? So it's going in steps. So on the left, we have the 80% government bonds outstanding and have some balancing other assets. I don't care what they are. Okay, because that stays the same throughout. I just wanted the balance sheets to balance. What matters is the changes that happen after that. Okay, when the government now issues these additional reserves and against an IOU that the government that the banking system issues to the government, what happens? Well, the government has this big claim. Debt-like claim on the private banking system, and it has issued money. What is this money? Okay, and this is normally, and this is, you know, Jamie has already explained it, but what is money? Well, this is a US banknote, and this is debt-backed money, just in the same way as our bank deposit is debt-backed money, because on the Fed's balance sheet, on the other side of this, sits government debt. It's backed by a different kind of debt, but it's still debt-backed money. This not terribly valuable thing is a coin issued by the Treasury, and this is treated in official US accounting conventions, as Jamie explained, and I love him for finding that out, as equity of the government, as equity in the commonwealth of the nation. Okay? And what the Chicago plan amounts to is basically to say that all money that exists out there should have this nature and not that nature. Okay? And so the government is now has acquired a huge equity position, and then it uses, for example, the citizens' dividend in order to pay some of that over to citizens, meaning that it shares some of this windfall with its citizens, meaning that in the final analysis, the government equity position is no longer as big as that. But it's still big enough that the net government debt becomes negative. So here is a government whose debt has gone from 80% of GDP to something negative. Really strong. And if we go back to this, here is a private system whose debt has gone from 180% of GDP to 80% of GDP. If you compare the loans that were there right at the beginning and now, there's only 80 there, there was 180 there before. So basically, we have removed a lot of the loans, a lot of the debt from the economy by switching from a debt-based money system to an equity-based money system. Okay, so I will now browse through. You said I have until 11:15 in the email. Is that still the game plan?
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. Yeah, fine. I'll be totally fine with that. I'll be totally fine with that. Sorry?
Steve took some of your time, so you should get some extra time. Don't rush.
All right. Complete elimination of bank runs. That one should be obvious. Okay, but it's sort of interesting to talk about a little bit. I already said money is completely safe here because its value no longer depends on the performance of some underlying loans that are backing it. And this whole notion of backing it goes back to this monetary stone age of the gold standard. But we basically still have it as far as our money supply is concerned. Credit problems, therefore, have no effect on the safety of the payment system, the lifeblood of the modern economy. If you think about Cyprus, for example, if you wanted to deal with Cyprus this way, you would basically then, or any country like Cyprus, you basically could deal with any problems that are in the credit sector without having to do anything to the transactions balances of households and firms that depend on these transactions balances for their solvency, for their ability to operate, because the two would be completely separate. That's all I want to say about that. Large output gains approaching 10%. This is, of course, the 10% we can discuss forever, because it very much depends on the numerical calibration of various aspects of the model. We were very careful. We documented it on 5 pages. If you want to argue with that, argue with those 5 pages, with the numbers on those 5 pages, and then we can talk. But I just want to illustrate the principles, or talk about the principles here. First of all, we get one reason is lower interest rates. Because any good economic model would tell you that there, if there is lower debt to equity ratios, leverage ratios, there are lower risk premia, and therefore lower overall real interest rates. And if you have lower overall real interest rates, you have higher investment, higher capital stock, higher GDP. And that's what's happening here. I'll show you in some simulations in a second. The next thing is lower tax rates due to the fiscal revenue from money creation. As I said yesterday to Jamie, you know, it's not Christmas, but it's about in my simulation, it's about 3.6% of GDP that you can collect every year from growing your money stock at the rate of economic growth without if the economy grows by 2%. If the economy grows by 2% a year, and your money stock is 180%, you can collect 3.6% of GDP seigniorage without creating any inflation. And you can use that seigniorage to reduce other forms of income raising, for example, distortionary tax rates on capital and labor that have negative effects on the amount of output in the economy. Third, lower monitoring costs. In this model, there is actually a concrete mechanism where when banks create money by debt, they have to sit there and constantly watch so that the collateral is good and the debt performs. That costs money. That takes resources. If you no longer create money through debt, you can redeploy those resources to elsewhere in the economy to produce actual useful goods and services. So this is sort of like saying, you know, not all of the people who work for Citibank, but a share of the people who work for Citibank, because they're no longer creating the money supply, but just intermediating, can now work for GE and make some real goods and services. That would also increase GDP. So here's a simulation. On the horizontal axis, in each case, you have quarters. So this shows a total of 15 years. The blue line in each case shows the actual transition once you implement the Chicago plan in the particular calibration that I used. The red dotted line shows where you will go in the very, very, very long run. So GDP increases significantly. It's mostly driven by investment. Investment, in fact, booms so much that consumption for a few quarters actually goes down so that people have enough resources to set aside to fund all this investment. Inflation drops by 3% because it's possible in this economy to run zero inflation. It's very difficult to do that in today's economy. There are very good reasons why you don't want to have zero inflation today. That's not the case under the Chicago plan. The lending rate here drops by over 200 basis points, by over 2 percentage points. That's because there's lower debt throughout the economy, risk premium decline. We talked about that. The labor tax rate drops by 5 percentage points because I'm deploying my seigniorage revenue that way. And this is what you see, this in the fiscal accounts here on the right-hand side. You see that the seigniorage to GDP ratio rises from zero, near zero, to about 3.6% of GDP, and it is used in order to reduce various distortionary taxes. Not to zero, but reduce them. Okay? Again, this is not Christmas. If you do this, for example, you have nothing left to spend on education or infrastructure or anything else. That has to come from somewhere else. Okay, no liquidity traps. The definition of a liquidity trap is that the central bank loses its ability to stimulate the economy by increasing the money supply or lowering the interest rate. Those are two common definitions of a liquidity trap, which is what we've been in for years. Right? It's a big problem for monetary policy. So this is very important. Okay. Under fractional reserve banking, I will talk now about the money supply story and the interest rate I will mention in passing. Under fractional reserve banking, the central bank only controls narrow money. And increasing broad money is, as you've seen a lot in the newspaper, it's like pushing on a string. Because you're entirely relying on the banks to take that narrow money and make it and use that as an incentive to create more broad money. And if they don't feel like it, you're pushing on a string.
Can you just define those two terms, narrow and broad money?
Narrow money is the reserves issued by the central bank and cash. And broad money is a very broad money supply like M3, M4, that includes time deposits and things like this. Includes even more, the broadest definitions include things like repos, but we don't want to go into technicalities here. Okay? So under the Chicago plan, the central bank directly controls broad money. All right? And so increasing broad money for a central bank in that world is like pushing on a steel rod. You push it, and the money is up because you control it directly. There is no liquidity trap here. Okay? And you can actually show that a similar argument holds for nominal interest rates, because for nominal interest rates we have the zero lower bound problem, which is in policy circles in everybody's on everybody's tongue these days, or has been for years. That actually also wouldn't apply, but it would take me too much time to explain why. Much better control of bank lending driven business cycles is the last advantage. So under fractional reserve banking, the extraordinary money creation privilege of banks is a major source of credit cycles. Because banks, when they feel like it and they want to lend more, they just create their own funds. They do not need to wait for granny to walk into the bank or for the truck to come with those carrots, right? They just go ahead and do it. Because, in addition to that, because these funds are at the same time the economy's medium of exchange, as Fisher called it, the circulating medium, they also have a government guarantee attached to it, because the government really needs to ensure that, you know, this is safe because it's the money supply, which makes the banks even more willing to lend because they know they're backed up by the government when they do this, right? Under the Chicago plan, this privilege is removed. Right? And so the intermediary banks must first persuade investors to make a deposit of cash. In terms of these balance sheets, actually, this is sort of saying, you know, if these guys up here want to lend, they need somebody from down here to move a slice of this money up here so that some of that, those reserves now sit on the credit part of the balance sheet, that can then be used to make a loan by that credit investment trust, and then flow back down here, right? So once somebody has done this, there is no government guarantee. I already mentioned this. There's no, there doesn't need to be, right? And so this is a risky investment. It could, in Kotlikoff's proposal, in fact, be equity. You could any time, any day, get a haircut. So that means investors that make this kind of investment will be much more cautious about doing this. So the bottom line is, in the prevention of credit cycles, two factors intervene to make the Chicago plan much safer. First, you remove the private control of money issuance so that this car that the banks have, they cannot produce its fuel on the spot. And there will also, in addition, be much greater investor caution in the use of the government money that does exist in this economy, because they know they can lose their shirt. Okay? And here's a little illustration of a credit cycle with GDP there at the top left. The solid line is the current monetary system, and the dashed line is under the Chicago plan. What I'm adding to it here is actually something similar to quantitative lending guidance, Richard Werner's favorite topic. And the only thing I want to point out to you is here for 3 years, these banks suddenly decide the economy has become a lot less risky, and they lend. Bank deposits go up by 50% of GDP. Bank loans go up by 50% of GDP, and this pumps up the real economy. There's an increase in GDP, etc. And then suddenly they turn on a dime, and credit and money decline by 50% of GDP. Of course, these are only illustrative magnitudes. I'm not saying that this could really happen in one quarter for various practical reasons. But in theory, in this current monetary system that we have, this could in fact happen. If banks say, look, we are really scared now, we want to get out, 50% of GDP cut in loans. If they had enough administrative capacity and weren't so totally afraid of alienating their customers by doing this overnight, they could. Okay? And a model of intermediation cannot explain why something like this could happen. This can only happen in a model with money creation or money destruction, which is what's happening here. Right? Whereas in the Chicago plan economy, because of quantitative lending guidance, what these banks do in the run-up in the run-up, they increase their capital cushion. Okay, this is the bank Basel ratio that we see there that has to be at a minimum of 8% of total assets, of risk-weighted assets in today's economy. And here we're saying if the banks want to increase their lending the way they are increasing their lending, then they need to put capital aside. And so then when the crisis hits, they have enough capital so that it doesn't tank the economy by nearly as much as it would under the Chicago plan, because the whole system of Basel regulations is actually much less effective when you have fractional reserve banking, because banks do not just create more money when they expand lending. The equity that you need in order to invest in banks and recapitalize banks is, it can be created alongside with that, because once the funds have been created, they are fungible. And they can also be turned into equity. So if everybody feels that the banks are not risky, then they just inject funds into the banking system, and the banking system grows, and the Basel ratios do not really impose a lot of constraints. Anyway, so I want to talk now briefly about inflation and then conclude.
Question period?
Sorry?
We'll have a question period.
It's up to you.
you.
Yeah. So will it cause inflation? I will argue that no, for three reasons based on monetary theory, monetary history, and the institutional arrangements that I would propose. Monetary theory, inflation is determined by the relative quantities of money and goods. Right? But it's money in private hands that people can actually spend on the goods that matters. Right? Under the Chicago plan, the quantity of money in private hands remains completely unchanged. The only thing that changes is what money represents. So therefore, from this point of view, from the theoretical point of view, this cannot be inflationary. These are, again, the balance sheets under the Chicago plan. Initially, finally, and in the middle is just after the backing for reserves has been put in place. If you look at deposits, they are virtually, I'm rounding a little bit here, but they are virtually identical for all three steps of the simulation. What changes is what is sitting on the other side of deposits. When I presented this at ECB, there was somebody there who said, "Or basically, you're changing from something where deposits are destructible because they represent loans that can either default or be called by the banks if they feel like it. So the money supply is very volatile because of that, potentially. Not necessarily, but potentially. Whereas here, you have a system that's based on indestructible money. Right? This money is just there and period. This is something, and you know, its value is determined by conservative issuance, and that's it. And so there's no inflationary tendency here. History, of course, everybody who has read Stephen Zarlenga's book and many other books knows that many distinguished thinkers have advocated government issuance under the rule of law, and that historical experience, and you have to go back centuries and millennia here and not just a few decades, is in favor of government money issuance. I just want to deal with one popular counter-argument which people say, well, look at Latin America, look at Zimbabwe, look at all these countries. Zimbabwe, by the way, is a very special case because they've had sanctions that makes this a very special case. But let's say Latin America or some of the, Hungary or all these things. Isn't that a counter-argument? Government basically misusing the monetary prerogative. I would ask, what monetary prerogative? Because in all these episodes, the system has been the same as what we have today, with quantitative differences in the sense that a larger portion of the overall money supply may have been publicly supplied, but still at the margin, the people who were responsible co-responsible for the overall money supply were banks in all of these systems. So therefore, to a significant extent, all those financial crises and inflations that we have seen in our history, we should ask ourselves, if banks are so responsible for the money supply, to what extent were they responsible for these financial crises? It's a legitimate question. And to just put the blame on the government is completely ill-informed. Finally, the institutional arrangements, I'm just saying here, you know, if you want to do this, make it a fourth power of government, where the monetary authority people would be similar to Supreme Court judges, because you do want them to be independent of government, because there is a temptation. What people are saying there, this argument for the central banker, is not irrelevant, okay? But you also want these people to be insulated from private influences. You want them to be insulated from all influences so that they do public policy on the basis of sound principles, right? And that means, roughly, if you can do it, grow the nominal money supply at the real rate of growth of the economy, using your best judgment of what that real rate of growth is, or perhaps a little bit more, because there are economic arguments for having just a very little bit of inflation. Last slide. The Great Recession has shown that too much of a dynamic, exciting, innovative financial system can really distract attention from the real economy, okay, and from the productive sector. For various reasons that I'm not going into today, I'm very concerned about energy availability going into the next decade or two. I think we need a really dynamic, productive sector. I would want people to study engineering, mechanical engineering, geology, and not financial engineering. Okay? So what we need is a really dynamic, productive sector and a really boring financial system. Meaning, a completely safe, 100% crisis-proof payment system. That's one part. And the other, separate part, would be lending banks that really do act like they are depicted in our textbooks as conservative intermediaries of publicly provided cash or sovereign money. Okay? And the Chicago Plan has many elements of such a system. I do have some people, I know some people at the IMF that I've privately talked to who are involved in financial reform, etc., at the country level, etc., and there's sort of various agendas of what do we need to achieve to make the system more resilient, to make a financial system in country X more resilient, and there's a checklist, right? If you take the Chicago Plan and you ignore the problem of how we get from here to there, which is of course very formidable, then you can make tick marks behind a lot of the items on that list. You would have a much safer financial system. The problem, of course, really, and it is formidable, is to how to get from here to there. Thank you.
Thank you.